I'm the moderator, so when we get to the Q&A, try to keep your questions short, maybe 30 seconds to a minute, but after that, I'll wonder if it's a statement or not instead of a question, and I'll probably step in to ask you to focus what exactly you're trying to ask. Try to respect the moderator's rules for tonight, and I'm sure we'll have a good presentation. Tonight we have two presenters, Justin Rose and Bernie Dehler. The topic's going to be, can the God of the Bible be shown to not exist? Bernie Dehler will be taking the position of a Christian presenting that view via the Bible and a particular author. Justin Rose will be taking the negative position to that. So whenever we're ready, Justin, you can go ahead and start with your 10-minute presentation.
Okay. Well, let me just add some preliminary thoughts too.
Sure.
You said that is no. These are just preliminary thoughts. I'll give you some preliminary thoughts if you want to, but just about the event, and also I just want to make clear that I am an atheist, and I'm representing a Christian tonight, so I'm going to be role-playing as I believe as a Christian, and I'm going to try to do my best job as a Christian would. So just because I'm saying something doesn't mean I believe it, and I'm also going to try to, you know, win one for the Christian side on this. The other thing is that one reason why this is an important event is because both sides lift up critical thinking, and there's an element in critical thinking called the charity principle, or principle of charity. And what that means is giving your opponent the best possible argument instead of saying, oh, this group is stupid because they believe, you know, some dumb thing. Instead, you look at their argument in the best possible light. And so by role-playing the other viewpoint, it kind of shows that you understand the other viewpoint. So it's a good skill to have. So overall, I think this is kind of an educational opportunity. Let's put the best ideas up there. And it's not about winning or losing, but just sharing ideas. So.
And one thing real quick to emphasize is Bernie's going to be also taking a respectful, sincere approach, because we want to do justice to Christians out there who very sincerely believe these things. There's no need for a mockery or, you know, satire. So he's going to try to represent in a way that tries to do justice to the position for those of you that find this very, very unusual or interesting presentation. Anything that you wanted to say, Justin, about your approach to this?
No, I'll probably cover a little bit, just my short introduction.
All right, very good.
So, an introduction, I just want to say that none of this is unique with me. In fact, nothing really earth-shattering has been said on the subject since probably David Hume. And even more recently, all I'm doing is just compiling arguments that you can find freely available anywhere and presenting them to you tonight. And I'm also not much of a public speaker, so I have most of this written out, and I'm going to try and present it in the best possible way that I can. The handout that you have is just some other sources and resources that you can use to investigate this on your own, because nobody's going to be convinced by a short speech in one night. And the way that you think about subjects like this is to take it at your own time, at your own pace, and do your own research. So I encourage you all to look up those sources. And if you don't want to keep that, then don't throw it away. There's a recycling bin up in the corner, so it's all environmentally responsible. I'm going to be defending two assertions. One, that the God of the Bible does not exist, and also that the God of philosophers is incoherent and not worth trying to prove or disprove. So first, I want to give you an illustration. This is a common saying that you hear theists and atheists alike say in these types of discussions, which is, you can't prove something doesn't exist. Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. To illustrate that, what if I were to say that I'm holding an orange in my left hand? Now, you can't see the orange, but this is a magical, invisible orange, and it's also incorporeal, so I can make my hand in the size that I want, it doesn't get crushed. Do we have to acknowledge that my magical orange claims can't be ruled out? We have to be magical orange agnostics. What the problem is we're arguing about labels in our belief systems. We're arguing about the possible characteristics of oranges. So let's replace the symbol orange with a substance. An orange, generally, is the ovaries of a particular tree from Earth. So am I holding the ovaries of a particular tree fruit in my hand? I'm not. If I say that I'm holding an invisible fruit in my hand, I'm not talking about an orange. I'm talking about something entirely different. Or maybe I'm talking about nothing. I'm talking about something that's incoherent and something whose definition is not standardized and may not be internally consistent. Something whose properties would change based upon what tests you try and apply to it and what objections you raise. And even further, it's absurd to talk about invisible magic oranges because we know what oranges are. If I say that I've discovered one, it would be reasonable for you to disbelieve me until I furnish some further convincing proof. Before I deal with the deity directly, what are some characteristics that make for a good explanation, something that we should look for? But here's an example of some explanatory desiderata from commonsenseatheism.com. A good explanation should have scope. It should have better explanations explain more types of phenomena. It should also be simple. It should make better explanations should make use of fewer claims that are yet unsupported or lack ad hocness. It should have a mechanism. Better explanations provide more information about underlying mechanisms. It should have predictive novelty. Better explanations don't just retrodict what we already know, but they can make predictions that we observe only after they're predicted. And their analogy, or fit with background knowledge. Better explanations generally fit with what we already know with some certainty. And of course, the grandfather of them all, testability. Better explanations would render specific predictions that can be falsified or corroborated. Predictions not sufficiently specific to be tested are similarly not useful. So let's talk about the God of the philosophers, the deistic God. So rather than arguing about what he is, I'm going to take some common attributes that are ascribed to him and test those for coherence with an eye to what we already consider to be a valid hypothesis that we just outlined. So he's incorporeal. He has no body or is non-physical. He's eternal. He's atemporal, and that for him everything is simultaneous, there being no past, present, and future. He's immutable, which is to paraphrase Anselm. By God, we mean an absolutely unsurpassable being, a being that cannot conceivably be improved upon. He's omnipotent. He can do anything that's logically possible. And he's omniscient. He can know everything that's logically possible to know. And he's also good. Whereas classical Greek religion ascribed to the gods very human foibles, theism from Plato onward has affirmed that God is purely good and cannot be the author of anything evil. So how do these properties fare when we combine them all together? Remove the label God and just place these all together in one lump. They're incoherent. And why is that? Well, God has no physical body. But remember what we said about a good explanation, that it fits with what we know. We know that minds don't exist without bodies. If your brain is damaged very specifically, your mind is damaged very specifically. Postulating a mind without a physical brain flies in the face of what we understand about minds. Eternity, God exists without side of space and time. But God is also attributed with creating the universe as a direct and intentional action. To do such a thing requires that you exist within time. You have to see that a gap exists, intend to act in such a way as to rectify the gap, and then act. All of this requires a series of events that occur one before the other inside of a framework of time. How about immutability? Well, if God existed before creation, before the universe, then there was a point when there was only God and nothing else. For God to engage in intentional act of creation, he had to envision a universe that was more perfect than him alone. He had to recognize a desire in himself, an acknowledgement that he wanted the state of affairs to change, and then intention to act to change them. How about omniscience? Does God know everything? Perhaps, but if he does, then he himself can't have free will, because then he knows his future actions perfectly, and thus he's obliged to act how he's foreseen himself to act. And finally, goodness and omnipotence. A God that is all good, and yet created the world that has evil baked into its very foundations cannot be good. This planet, and possibly others, has drifted for billions of years soaked in natural evil. Animals, great to small, without any original sin doctrines tacked on, have devoured each other alive, with only God as a passive witness. Changing the page. Many theists will also argue that this is probably the most perfect world that can allow free will and maximize goodness. But Bernie obviously believes that heaven exists and heaven contains free will, and it doesn't contain evolution or predation or natural evil or suffering. So a better world is possible for God to have created, but he did not. We can see from these examples that the God of the philosophers is incoherent. If we replace the symbol God with the substance that we've outlined, we come up with a terrible mess. It doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. but it does mean that any discussion about it is hopelessly ad hoc, defining God as ways that may logically fit rather than tied to any type of actual physical and testable phenomena. It's a lesson in philosophic gerrymandering, where we define our label from the top down, rather than the bottom up, trying ahead of time to get it to fit into our conditions. It cannot be disproved because it cannot be defined, and where it is defined is internally incoherent. So I've shown that the God of the philosophers is incoherent, so now I want to take a few moments and talk about Yahweh, the God of the Bible. I started with the God of the philosophers because it's a more defensible position, which is why it was invented. Yahweh is not the God of the philosophers. He's a complex character. He's not the simple archetype of smooth perfection. He gets angry. He can be persuaded. He gets jealous. He talks to his prophets as a person with a personality. He punishes the wicked on earth. He directs the course of a small nation. He intervenes in the smallest and most redundant affairs of men. He turns sticks into snakes. He brings plagues. He murders. He heals. And even fathers a child. And even though in 1 John it says that no man has seen God, in Exodus, Moses gets to look at Yahweh's back. He, which no greater can be imagined, has a back. And the Bible is also wrong. Genesis 1 and 2 not only conflicted themselves, but they conflicted what we know about the origin of species and humans included. Genesis gives a description of the world that involves a flat earth, below it. Joshua tells the sun to stand still, not understanding that it's not the sun that's moving, it's the earth that's rotating. There's also some failed prophecies. Here's a couple of quick examples from Genesis. Yahweh promises Abram and his descendants all the land of Canaan, but both history and the Bible show that that promise was not fulfilled. God promises to bring Jacob back safely from Egypt, but Jacob dies in Egypt. So the God of the Bible is a theatrical character throughout Jewish history. He's the ultimate patriarch. There's no more reason to think that this God exists than to think that Zeus exists. And to recap, the God of the philosophers, or the deistic God, is incoherent and inconsistent, and any true statements that about that God are necessarily false because they cannot stand together without conflict. The God of the Bible is a literary character that is no more believable or credible than Wotan or Thor or Superman. When he was upgraded to the God of the philosophers in order to make him less provincial, he simply created a whole new class of problems that make him even less credible. So until some new evidence is put forth by theists like Bernie, and reason and rationality leave us no other alternative than to say that the God of the Bible does not exist.
And it's exactly 10 minutes.
Thank you. Yep.
Tough
crap. Yeah. Now we'll have Bernie Dehler for his presentation for the question, can the God of the Bible be shown not to exist? He'll be in there for against that question.
Can you set your camera on mute?
Yep.
I have it already set. Okay. Can you see that, Tom?
I got it right here.
Okay, because this one's a really nice visual. Okay. Okay, so just to give you an executive summary on this. For example, Justin brought up some specific prophecies and things like that. It's hard to rebut those if I didn't know those in advance. So basically, the main thrust here is going to be a general way of looking at things. Because if I brought up something specific too, you'd be at a disadvantage to try to talk about that. So I just want to have a general idea here.
I lost my PowerPoint.
So overall, obviously God exists. I mean, just look around, hello. You know, here we are. Look at people, look at how amazing life is. It's incredible. So basically, evidence is in the complexity of nature. As, for example, even this the science of biology, for one thing, when you look at just how mind-boggling it is, when you learn about DNA and how the body works. The evidence is also experiential, to anyone who has a personal relationship with Jesus knows. There's, you know, you feel like you have a real communion with God. And I would say of all the different religions, sure, there's a lot of different religions that have different views of God, but when you look at the theology, that Christianity would make the most sense. So given that there God obviously exists, the idea is then which God is that? And so if you study them all, I would say Christianity makes the most sense. And finally, I'd say, why do people say there's a problem with believing in God? Well, they say it's because of reason and science, and I would say it's because they have a faulty view of how science interfaces with the Bible. So I want to go, so how should Christians look at the Bible? How should they interpret the Bible? And the role model here is Dennis Lamoureux, who is a professor in Canada. And he has this position called evolutionary creationism. So basically, when you look at the different realms of way to interpret the scripture, you have younger creationism, which denies almost all of modern science, older creationism, which accepts the cosmological and geology pretty much, but then will reject biology. And so now you have evolutionary creationism, which says we accept all of modern science, and we're going to interpret the Bible in light of that. So here's this picture, and there's this online paper here. This is a really good paper. It's a very succinct description of how to do this, and so that's what I'm basically going over. The book is much thicker, talks about the same thing. So here's some important terms and concepts. There's basically two divine books. There's God's words and God's works. It's not the Bible versus science. Everything's from God. God's the one who invented science. God's the one who invented people. So there's no conflict. So what you have to do is you have to interpret them in light of each other. The Bible is not a science nor a history textbook. It's a book of theology. It talks about God and he wants to have a relationship with you. You're a sinner, how to get redeemed. It's not trying to teach you about science. That was never the goal of it. So when you say, well, look how silly it is against science, well, of course, it wasn't meant to be a science textbook. Concordism is a term which means how closely the Bible relates to science. So a young earther, for example, would say that, a young earth creationist would say, oh, well, the Bible speaks correctly when it talks about science, and so I would disagree with that. And an old earther would say, well, you know, the Genesis account of creation pretty much aligns with how it really happened in science. And again, I disagree with that. The Bible is not trying to teach you science, it's trying to teach you theology about your relationship with God and how God is the creator. The Bible has an ancient Near Eastern conceptualization of science. I'll show you an illustration of that. Right here, it's called a three-tiered universe. For example, they thought the Earth was flat. It was circular like a coin. It was immovable. There's a dome structure above a body of water over the Earth. And what separated those two was the firmament. And the sun moved across the sky. This is everything they perceived, and so they thought it was real. And there was nothing wrong with that. We just have more technology, so we know telescopes and these other scientific instruments that the Earth is not immovable. It's spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, going through space, 68,000 miles per hour, around the sun. The sun is moving and spinning. The Milky Way is moving and spinning. All these things are new that they didn't have. Okay. There's intelligent design. The Discovery Institute has a version of intelligent design, which is kind of a God of the gaps, like God had to step in and create things. But this view says that God used evolution as his design method. God doesn't have to step in. So the traditional intelligent design is like Psalm 19:1. Here about the heavens, declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech, night after night they reveal knowledge. So it's just, you know, just looking at creation, it just screams out that there was a creator. And for an analogy of it, I'm going to give you an analogy of embryology with evolution. You know, like when a sperm meets an egg, it's one cell. But everything in that cell has all the information to create a human. Trillions of cells, specialized cells, the brain, how complex that is. All that stuff is in that one cell. In the same way, from the Big Bang, boom, all that information was in there so it could unravel. That was God's marvelous forethought. And the example is with a different creationist position. It's kind of like playing a game of pool, billiards. The younger creationists would say, like, there's all these balls on the table, and let's say if you had the balls in three groups. One is heavens, earth, and then biological life. They say, according to that, God would like sink each one individually. He had to do each one. The older creationists would say, like, well, with one shot, God made all of the balls in the group that had to do with the heavens and the earth sink all at once. And then he shot, for biological life, he shot them individually, because this means he had to do individual creations for the animals and humans. But, you know, so it's more of a trick to hit more balls in at once. So actually, this evolutionary position shows God's even more grander, because basically with one shot, he made all the balls go in the right order at the right time. So it actually shows, evolution actually shows the glory of God more than what a young Earth creationist or an old Earth creationist would say. And obviously, when you look at scripture, you know, the young earther might look at that and say, well, you know, it says God made the sun on day four, so therefore he made the sun on day four. It's literally, there it is, I believe it. Well, actually, you have to look at the genre, and there's obvious poetic structures in the Bible. To show you in here, this is, when you look at like, the Hebrew words are like there's tohu and bohu, it says, at the very start of this. And so, basically the idea is 1, 2, and 3 is all about God creating form. Like in day one, he created the forms of light and dark. Day two, separated the waters from above and below. Day three, separated water from the land. That was all creation. Creating form from non-form. And then the parallel panel is he goes to a feeling. So on day four, look at how it relates to day one. Day four, he puts the stars, the moon, and the sun, moon, and stars in the sky. So first, you know, so that relates to where he made the light. Number five, he now fills the waters with the sea creatures, and he fills the skies with the birds. And number six, he fills the land with land animals and humans. And then day seven is the final summary of that, how he rested. So this is a poetic structure. It's not meant to be like literal day 1, 2, 3. Here's another one about the worldwide flood. You notice how it starts off in the story and then it comes back. The very center of it is God remembers Noah. So what was the event before that? Well, 150 days or waters prevailed. After that, 150 days. So you can see it's called a chiasm. It's a form, and the reason why they wrote like this is because it helps them remember it when they retell it. So obviously, God didn't do things like there were 7 days waiting, and then 40 days, and 150, and then the event happened, and a reverse 150, 47. Obviously, things don't happen like that. It's to show you a story to teach you theological truths, so you can retell it and remember it easier. So basically, there's a message incident principle, meaning the message, God gave people a message, but the science and the history is incident. It's not important. I mean, today, God gave the message, how humans were created, may use math equations, but it's not important because the point is that God created and man is a sinner and man can be redeemed through Jesus. So all that I'll just summarize with, you know, the heavens declare the glory of God. Just look around. This is incredible. And God loves you and wants a relationship with you. And if you read the Bible, you know, with devotion, you'll see something with your eyes that you won't see if you're just a critic. So that's it. It's an invitation for everybody to find God if they want to.
Thank you, Bernie. Now we'll have Bernie and Justin. We'll take about 10 minutes for them to ask each other some questions. From the presentation, I might interject some questions of my own as they go for about 10 minutes here. So, Justin, was there a particular part of Bernie's presentation that stood out to you as a central piece?
I have a question for Bernie. Sure. I think that Bernie's presentation really illustrated why Christianity is a horrible explanation for the way to look at the world, because he said that we can see that complexity comes from God, and evolution was involved, but God has hand in it. It was creationary evolution, or that the Big Bang happened, but that God was behind the Big Bang. There's him shooting blue balls around. And my question would be, you've just taken a normal explanation and stacked God on top of it, and it actually doesn't improve the explanations of why these things happen at all. It's just a not necessarily a tautology, but it's a teleology that you use to interpret it. So why does placing God on top of the science that we already understand make that explanation better?
Real quick, can you explain to the audience what's a teleology?
You place purpose on top of something that's happened that doesn't necessarily demand purpose.
Well, I think one of your arguments basically is that science has the answer, so why throw God on top of it? And science has a lot of holes. And one of the biggest problems is that science, by definition, does not even allow God into it because it's called science's methodological naturalism. In other words, you can't put God in a hypothesis and say, my hypothesis is that God created the earth and now I'm going to do an experiment to show it, because God doesn't perform tricks on command like that. So by the very definition of science, it is limited to anything supernatural. And I would say there's incredible, it's not like science has all things figured out, so why just throw God on there? There's incredible mystery. I mean, for example, I used to think about, for example, speakers, if you design anything, like let's say, for example, you design a phonograph player or anything that has a speaker that makes sound, a lot of people think they understand how a speaker works, but all they're doing is they know how to build the thing. They know that if they apply electrical voltages, they can make things, but as far as really understanding, like, deeply what's really happening there, moving the air and making things, I mean, there's a lot of things we just don't know.
Yeah, but I'm not talking about things we don't know, because there's plenty that we don't know. In fact, there's probably more that we don't know than we do.
Exactly.
But I think, to use your speaker analogy, what you're saying is that we know how speakers came to be, we know who put them together and how they work, and that's fine. Science has determined that for us, and we celebrate that. But the speaker is God's purpose for us to listen to his rock music, and I'm going to place that on top of how we understand speakers work, and you can't test that, but I'm asserting that that's the purpose of the speaker.
Well, I'm not even sure we understand how speakers work. I mean, for example, one thing I think about is there's four dimensions, you know, there's the X, Y, Z, and there's time. Okay, and then with string theory, scientists think there's six more dimensions. And we can't even imagine a fifth dimension. So here we can't even imagine a fifth dimension. There may be 10 dimensions. I mean, it just shows the ignorance we have is incredible. I mean, it's, of course there's things we don't know. I mean, it's like what we do know is a fraction of a fraction. And just like humans are a speck, it's been said humans are a speck on the Earth, which is a speck in the solar system, which is a speck in the galaxy. I mean, what we know is a speck of reality, and God is so complex. I mean, they just discovered DNA, how to write it. They're still trying to figure out what the genes are doing. And, you know, if God designed all this stuff, it's not a mystery to him. He's the guy who made all this stuff. So
let me ask you this in line with that, then. Since we know that there's things that we don't know, and then we know that there's things that we partially know, my assertion would be that even if we don't know what the mechanism behind something is, we still know what a bad explanation for that mechanism is. So say before Newton, so we didn't know about gravity, we didn't have laws for gravitation. If an apple were to fall on somebody's head and I said, that apple fell on his head because God flipped it off, that's still a bad explanation, even if we don't know anything at all about gravity, for the above reasons that I stated, that in that case, we don't know if we're right because there's no way for us to know if we're wrong. We can't test that God didn't flip that off the top of the tree. And so my question to you is, how do you know that you're right if you're saying that there's no way for us to know if we're wrong?
I don't know, it's kind of a convoluted question. I'm not sure if I got it clearly. I mean, I believe by faith, too. It's not like I know that I'm right, but I believe in God. I feel like there's a relationship with God.
Personal experience.
Right. That's one thing. I mean, just looking around intellectually, too. I mean, the complexity.
That's fine. I mean, so if you want to use personal
experience. I mean, to think there's no God and everything just self-assembled. I mean, look at this. Everything just, your complex brain just self-assembled all by itself, by natural. Natural, I mean, it's.
But let me ask you this, then. If, well, actually, you should probably ask me a question.
Okay. Let me ask Justin a question real quick. So, yes, you brought up that there are such things as bad explanations. We have answers to things, but still, the explanation is bad, and it's bad. Aren't there certain assumptions that scientists have, like cause and effect? We can't exactly prove cause and effect, but it's nevertheless an assumption, and the scientist has a confidence, a faith in that assumption.
Yeah, I would say there would be a confidence, but it doesn't have to be that way. I mean, there's no reason why this universe has to be in such a way where testability and naturalism is what functions. It could just have easily have been that I want to know how to develop an airplane, so I'm going to pray over it, and I'm going to get that knowledge. But we don't live in that universe. We live in a universe where things that we test, that we assume that there's cause and effect, functions. and that's what's worked for us for the last.
I think it's presumptuous for you to say that as if you know a different kind of alternate universes God could have made and this one has a shortcoming. I mean, our intelligence, we don't have that kind of intelligence to make that kind of analysis.
I don't particularly think that there are other dimensions, but if you were, I don't have to say that there are in order to explain
it. No, I meant other options. You're saying that you're against the idea that this is the best possible creation scenario. There could have been other creation scenarios that would be better. I don't think, I mean, you have to have a godlike knowledge to know that kind of stuff, to make that kind of comparison.
So you're saying again, though, that we can't know for wrong?
Because it depends on what the specific topic is. I mean, if you said there's 100,000 elephants in here, I'd say you're wrong.
What if they're higher dimension than this right now?
Yeah, so I mean, it depends. I mean, what you said, no, I really see them, they're really physical animals here. I could say, no, you're wrong. If you said everybody in here is wearing a green shirt, I could say you're wrong.
Right.
So I mean, there's certain things that are obviously wrong, and sure. Some things we just don't have the ability because we don't have that kind of information.
Yeah, but if we don't have the ability to know that they're wrong, then why do we have the ability to say that they're right?
Can you be more succinct on that?
Yeah. If there's no prediction that you can make that says I will know that I'm wrong in this assertion if X, Y, Z happens, then you can't say I know I'm right in this assertion because you don't know what wrong looks like. You have no way to differentiate the two.
Well, I think the idea of trying to prove God or not, if he exists, it may just take more data that we have, more data and knowledge that we have at this point. I mean, imagine Neanderthals trying to prove it. It's like, how could they even get close to it? Well, if we're that naive, we don't even know how to experience more than four dimensions, how could we even approach it? Maybe we're as dumb as Neanderthals compared to what we could be or something. You know, just the bottom line, though, remember, my position has no issue with science at all whatsoever. So,
just a real quick question, both of you, what, Justin, would be the most important part of your presentation that comes to mind that you would want to leave the audience with, and for Bernie, what is the most important part of your presentation that lays the heart of what you were trying to say? Yeah, go ahead, Justin, if you would.
Form your beliefs with an eye to falsifiability. If you want to believe that something is true, that's great, but make sure you know what's going to happen if it's not. Because if you don't tie your belief systems to any type of physical phenomenon or physical testability, then you're just believing in free-floating systems that can never be proven wrong. And if you care about being right, which not everybody does in all things, then you should care about knowing what it's going to look like when you're wrong.
And I would say I agree with that too. That doesn't bother me at all. I 100% agree with you. I would just like to leave people to know that this evolutionary creationist position says there's absolutely no conflict between science and the Bible because of the way things are interpreted with this system. It's not young earth creationism. It's not older creationism. It's evolutionary creationism. There's no conflict. So,
can I say something?
We're now done with the dialogue, and so now we'll be going on to the Q&A. So yeah, this would be a great time to bring up whatever questions you have. And any question, or quote about any question is a good question. You'll get respect here. Let's just allow this to be a place where we just share, and so it's enjoyable and effective. Go ahead, sir.
Well, let's say like this, in this phase of the, if we're getting some more intelligent product on the industry, so somebody stay behind, you know, and bring his intellectual knowledge to create something. You know, like, for example, you know, computer. Let's say 50 years ago, it wasn't a computer at all, you know, as kinetic, you know, was. Cyber, you know, something like that in mind of the people, but nobody was physically touched like you do today, you know, but people been pouring a lot of effort, you know, to create something, you know, to progress to create that. So, and that chip today, which is the size of the pencil, you know, it used to be even 30 years ago the size of this building, okay. So everything was a perfect knowledge or perfect creation and stays behind something perfect brain, you know, or some put effort to do that, you know, to put brain, to put design, to put knowledge to form that place. So, and that perfect universe, and I'm not going to say the perfect universe because we don't know about that, but we know us, you know, we people, and our brain is multifunctional as a billions computers at the same time. So, if it's amazing, you know, if it's creation, stupid environment, it cannot create anything beside that not physical or non-organic formula. And suddenly they create a super brain computer, which is, we call it brain. So, and that comes up, you know, super powerful, equal, you know, to billions, billions today computers. So what do you think? Is just a simple lightning, you know, strike, and that something comes up, you know, to exist, or that should be somebody behind that? I'm not saying true to God over that, but I'm just, you know, philosophically trying to figure out if it's possible without God to create like that high level organism like a human brain.
Does, I think that question is for me. For is that
probably for you? Yeah.
Okay. For, I think what you're talking about is complexity shows that there's design, or that we would expect to see a designer if we see complex systems, something like the human brain. And I guess my response to that would be, if in fact the brain, or in fact people, or anything was designed intentionally, then there's a whole lot of bad design that goes along with it. Just like, you know, say you have an apple pot, bad design, right? But what you see is
bad design. What you say?
Bad design. Like, for instance, the male prostate or the male urethra runs through the prostate,
which is no good.
That's bad design.
Most of the time, that's a perfect design.
No, I wouldn't even say any of the time. Actually, our brains don't work very well when we try and think about repetitive tasks. We can be subconsciously influenced without our knowledge, depending on what smells that are available to us when we make decisions, which are really our moral decisions. Incidental damages to your brain can leave you with impaired cognitive abilities or with a different personality entirely. And it's all entirely physical, too. If I drink a fifth of vodka, I'm going to be a different person than if I have no vodka in my system, because your brain's a chemical machine and it can be influenced chemically. And so to say that somehow it has some type of purposeful design, I would say I don't see the evidence of that. I see complexity that arises from simplicity, just like how you could start with an extremely simple formula for gravity that only creates one constant, two masses at a distance, and you can have a solar system, which is incredibly complex, because sometimes simplicity comes from complexity, and that seems to be the way the universe works.
Thank you. Just happens spontaneously. Did you have a response to that, Bernie, of this man's question of how complexity shows that there's design?
Right. There's something I want to say that I agree with what Justin said, and something I disagree with. First of all, I guess the disagreement is that this position does say evolutionary creationism is that design is evidence. So what you see in creation here is evidence of a designer. But, so I disagree with Justin on that, but where I agree with Justin is that God was not needing to intervene. Like, he didn't have to spark life from non-life. It was all part of his upfront planning. I mean, from the Big Bang, it could all roll out naturally. Just like, for example, when a human is conceived as a baby, the body grows by itself. No Christian thinks that God has to come down and paste on a nose.
Some do.
And add some arms, add a leg, clear out the ears. They don't think God does that stuff like that. They believe that God's design is made so it can unroll from that. So according to this position, everything can unroll from God's design. That's why I gave that analogy earlier, like playing pool. The young earther thinks that God had to shoot each ball individually into the pocket, whereas this one says one bang, and they all went into the pockets. So just to make an agreement and disagreement there. I agree with you that creation shows a creator, but I disagree with like the Discovery Institute, who says, oh, well, somehow the design wasn't sufficient enough. God had to step in and create humans or create animals and dogs and cats because you can't get that from evolution. No, we believe that God's plan up front was able to design that up.
Among Christians, I would say the position you've taken here today is probably in the minority. Aren't most Christians leaning more towards the fundamentalist view of life and the, those that are young earth creationists, most of them, I guess, that I've heard speak anyway or write, that they wouldn't accept your position you put on today, that evolution is perfectly fine. They don't accept evolution in any shape or form. To them, they take the Bible literally, word for word.
That's a really good question. So the way I would say is that with evangelical Christians, there's, the ones who want to preach the gospel, they're on TV, and they have, they teach people to evangelize and stuff like that. There's young earth creationists who are a minority, but they're very loud, and so people think they're a majority. Most of them are probably like older creationists, which still reject evolution, and this position is probably the smallest, and it is, close to being called heresy in that position.
That's my background.
But when you go outside evangelical Christianity and you go more to mainstream Christianity, like even some Lutheran churches and Presbyterian and Catholic and all that stuff, they're more like, well, of course, I have no problem with evolution. So it's just that the young earthers are actually a very small minority, but they're very loud. And so it kind of gives the idea that most people are like that. But especially amongst the academics, the young earthers are not.
I saw the results of a survey done recently that doesn't agree with what you're saying. They showed the percentage of people that believed in different concepts, and it was a very high percentage that believed basically in the evangelical point of view that everything was created at once, and that the young earth concept. And as it went down through the different viewpoints, it was fairly high. Then another survey showed that the more education you have, the less likely you were going to be a fundamentalist, that you would be lean towards the position that you've taken here today. I think it seems to correlate to education, that the more educated you become, you accept other possibilities than the strictly biblical version of life.
Well, yeah, see, from my understanding is there's evangelical Christianity in the pews and in the churches, and then there's evangelical Christianity in the seminaries. And they are not the same, they are not tracking. And right now the seminaries and things are debating evolution. And Dennis Lamoureux, for example, he's one of the guys who's trying to break the ice. So there's a huge crisis right now, actually, with the academics, I think. But most people in the pew, I don't think, have any idea about that. So, of course, if you're going to do a poll, you're going to get most of the people, even the pastors, if you ask them a lot of questions about evolution, they're going to probably say, I don't know, because I've talked to pastors. They're busy. They're busy ministering and preaching and doing other things, and they don't see this as an important thing. But in the academics, I'm just saying there's a big mismatch between the academics and the pew, and I think it'll take a number of years, but it's going to roll down. So
the position you've taken today, would, to me, it sounds like you would be more of a deist than a theist.
Well, this is why the actual name is important, of evolutionary creationism. So creationism is the noun, evolutionary is the adjective. So basically it shows the importance of an evangelical standpoint. The traditional word, it was kind of like a theistic evolutionist, which means evolution is the key thing and theistic is a modifier. So that's one knock against theistic evolution. The other one is that theistic could mean a lot of things, deist, Christian, pantheist, whatever. So this whole position here of evolutionary creationist is actually, I think, defined and made up by Dennis Lamoureux to show that this is an evangelical position, and he's defining it. So.
Do we have some more questions?
question about human consciousness. How does evolution fit into that?
I think probably as best we know now, I'm not a neuroscientist or neurobiologist, is that consciousness exists on different levels. And it somehow is, maybe the best way to put it would be a simulation, in the sense that it's something that the brain creates in order for you to interact with the world around you. And when you're younger, you have a different consciousness. And other animals have other levels of consciousness. It's tied to brain size and complexity, but not directly. For instance, some birds can use tools. You know, some other higher primates can do sign language and have a pretty decent sized vocabulary. So consciousness is subjective and also seems to be intensely physical. If you damage certain areas of your brain, then you can lose the ability to recognize faces or remember names. You know, or you may lose your sense of smell. Or you may go blind, but still actually be able to see subconsciously and be able to avoid objects because it's not connected to your prefrontal cortex, but still your eyes are connected to your visual cortex. So all sorts of odd things can happen. It's a complex system. It doesn't always work well, but it tends to work fairly well.
Can I ask you?
I wanted to follow on too. As far as consciousness arising, I think we would agree because we both are 100% for science and that humans evolved from other animals and consciousness arose with the brain. But also I would say that humans are built in the image of God, and that's something that is unique that humans have that not animals don't have. And then exactly, so how did this image of God come to be? This is what Professor Lamar always says. That's kind of a bit of a mystery yet. It's just probably too complex for our feeble minds to understand right now. But that's what makes us different than the animals, is that we have the image of God and they don't.
Go ahead, sir.
The same question was the lady asked you. I'd like to ask a little bit different. The consciousness we have, but inside of the realization of the consciousness, we have conscience itself. So kind of a little voice in our brain always, define, that's good or bad. So beside the consciousness, we have a little of something, which is, what we call a conscience, as my kids usually used to watch, Pinocchio, so that little cricket was appearing in your conscience for a wooden boy. So how do you explain that situation, simply in the brain, we have a little more complexity, functioning, and that's the most important thing here for the community, and like Bernie says, animals doesn't have it.
But I think what you're talking about is probably Cartesian dualism. You're saying that we have a common conscience that seems to be above and beyond what our normal consciousness and brain function would be.
How do you call that?
Cartesian dualism, the homunculus that sits inside your brain and kind of controls things that's non-causal. It makes the ultimate decisions for us. In fact, Descartes said that the pineal gland is how that interacts with our physical body. Most people don't actually remember that. But I would say that it doesn't really need to be explained as mysterious. For instance, depending on what your parents told you when you were very young, you would think many very different things were right or wrong. Depending on what society you grew up in, you think things were different for right or wrong. In fact, things that you thought were right or wrong probably have changed throughout your life. In fact, if you're a judge, and this has been studied, if you have to make a judgment on a criminal before lunch, you're going to be much more harsher in your sentencing than you will be after you have a healthy breakfast or a healthy lunch. Also, if I ask you to wash your hands and face before you decide what the sentence should be, you'll give a lighter sentence than if you feel like you need to, or if you've watched images that make you feel dirty or unclean. So to say that there's something that is somehow beyond the physical realm that helps us to pass judgment outside of our brains, I would say there's no evidence at all.
Just to compliment what the two audience members are trying to emphasize about consciousness, it is still not something that scientists are at a consensus on what is the actual working model of consciousness. what really is consciousness? Is it a part of the brain, or is it some form of reality that's separate from the brain? And
seems to me look like a separate.
Yeah, if you go to an international convention on cognitive science as it tries to understand consciousness, you'll see philosophers there, psychiatrists, psychologists, all with their particular theories on consciousness. And for every one that's there, there's a different theory on how it is. What may be, and you comment on this either if you want, what may be the most difficult part about consciousness is our ability to objectively try to understand it, because we're using our consciousness to try to understand consciousness, and so that makes it subjective. Any thoughts on
Well, I just want to say I'm not sure what Lamoureux's position on this would be, because mainly it's about how to interpret the Bible in light of science and how the two interact. So I'll just read you a couple sentences here that he says. I mean, I imagine that he would say, you know, if you feel direction or warnings and conscious, if your consciousness or your conscience bothers you, maybe that could be God working with you. I'm not sure, but I'll just read this. He says, evolutionary creationists experience the Father's love and presence in their lives. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, they drink deeply from the Bible and enjoy an everlasting source of spiritual nourishment for their soul. And these Christian evolutionists meet the Lord Jesus in a personal relationship, which at times involves both dramatic and subtle answers to prayer, as well as miraculous signs and wonders. So, it could be a communication with God. Yeah, the soul and the spirit, they're actually deep. If you go to Bible college, I have a seminary degree, and if you go to seminary school, some seminaries just gloss over it as, oh yeah, we all know what a soul or a spirit is. But I have one textbook by Millard Erickson, which I really like. It's called Christian Theology, I believe. And it goes into great depth about different views of what the soul is, and so it's a lot more complex than people talk about, generally speaking. So it's a complicated subject.
And I want to stress also that something that's non-intuitive or something that's extremely complex doesn't necessarily mean it's wrong. For instance, quantum mechanics is almost impossible to understand. I don't understand it at all. Most people don't understand it. But it renders very specific predictions that are incredibly accurate. So it can be tested, and it can be falsified, it can be shown to be right, even if it's incredibly complex and almost completely ununderstandable. But what Bernie said about having a personal experience, a personal relationship, and knowing that something is true, I would say that a lot of people say that they channel aliens from other dimensions. A lot of people say that they've been abducted and gone ahead as common. You know, a lot of people say that they hear the voices of, you know, other creatures that are talking to them. These are all experiences that I don't doubt that they experienced, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's correct. And there's really no way of knowing it's correct unless you actually decide you're going to test it one way or another and see which way it works out. Well, it comes from different places. When I was a Christian, then there was guilt, feeling like I wasn't living up to what God wanted me to do, or I was violating whatever His commands particularly were. I guess I should say rather God than the particular Christianity that I was part of, because as you see today, that there's a wide disagreement among what Christianity is and what God wants us to do, even amongst Christians. Since then, the guilt that I have is typically if I know that I didn't do as well as I wanted to be able to do, or if somebody that I cared about I let down or offended, if I had a personal relationship with somebody and I knew that I damaged that relationship, or if I knew that there was more that I could do to help somebody or something and I didn't do it because of my own problems, if that's where my guilt comes from.
So you have personal standards that you
I basically surveyed what the different philosophical life stages were and then chose one that made sense to me. And I haven't actually settled on anything concrete yet, but I'm generally a utilitarian in the sense that I believe that suffering is real. People certainly experience suffering and they feel it. And so that is something that actually exists in the world, and it's something that I have a reason to try and reduce wherever I can, because I would be reducing something that people don't want to experience and people do experience. And that doesn't have to be physical, of course, that can be emotional. And so that's what I use for something.
So a quick question for Justin. So do you feel that you have some of the same type of guilt or shame over doing something wrong that to the same degree that, say, a Christian?
Yeah, where our standards overlap, I would say yes.
Bernie, did you have any thoughts that you want to put on that?
I don't think you'd have the same level of guilt. I mean, we're going to answer to God one day for what we do wrong. If you do something wrong, it's your conscience, big deal, who cares, right? I mean, you're not going to have to worry about that.
So let me ask you this in line with that, though. Since there's a lot of different Christianities, and a lot of different Christians say different things are wrong, how do you know what's going to upset God the most? To quote Homer Simpson, what if we have the wrong religion every time we go to church, just making God madder and madder?
Well, that's what I just said. When I think it's obviously God exists when you look at all the different theologies. I think Christianity makes more sense.
No, I'm not talking about other than Christianity. I'm talking within Christianity.
Same thing.
Some Christian churches allow gay marriage and having women as ministers. Some that would get you knocked out on, you know, out on the street. Some handle snakes. Some think that would be horrible.
Yeah, see, this is what I said about the very start. It's kind of difficult to get into specific things because it's you know, if you bring up something where maybe you've studied and I haven't had a chance yet, if I would have known in advance you were going to bring it up, I could have given you a good response for it. So this is basically a broad brush thing about how do you interpret the Bible in the light of science and things like that. So
what it sounds like to me is that you're relying on your own conscience.
Well, like I said, there's no problem with science and the Bible. Why is that? Well, because it makes sense. And Dennis Lamoureux has three PhDs. He has two in science and one in
dentistry.
Yeah, dentistry is a science, though.
Yeah.
It's a science that, I mean, compares teeth across different animals, I think, over even ancient animals and things, too. You can see the evolutionary changes of teeth. I think it was along that lines. So
that's valuable. I've been to bad dentists.
So, I mean, we agree that we should use reason to the best of our ability. If there's competing Christian, you know, for example, the young earther will say, well, look at the Old Testament. It says day one this, day two this, day three this. And I said, okay, let's look at for education. Let's look at it. We can see it's a poetic structure. It's not meant to be a narrative of exactly literal how it happened. So, you know, the more education you have, you can come up to a higher level in your interpretation.
So, I mean, let me correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds like you're saying that.
I mean, atheists disagree too. It's not like all atheists are in agreement. So why do you find it surprising that Christians would disagree?
I would say that because atheists use different, they use different and even conflicting bases for their